before making a brief introduction to the topic, I just wanted to have a joint here by the two experts on nutrition that have been so kind to fly over for this meeting. You know, I'm extremely proud to introduce them both to you. Both have one thing in common. They've been challenging the status quo of nutrition and brought nutrition science to a new level. And obviously you'll see some of the conclusions and some of the new findings that they will present to you. Some of those are obviously not yet generally accepted. So I'm introducing first Professor Robert Lustig, which is Professor of Pediatrics and Endocrinology at the University of California in San Francisco. And he's been, yesterday I quoted him wrongly as the grandfather of the sugar tax in the UK. He's actually the godfather of the of the sugar tax in the UK. Also, yesterday, I made a mistake introducing him to a dinner of saying that his video on YouTube was watched by 1.5 million people. Actually, I have to correct that. You know, his video, which is Sugar, a Bitter Truth, was seen by 6.3 million people on YouTube. And that shows you the interest, right, that the topic has, plus, obviously, his competence. I want to stress also that this video was an hour and 29 minutes video, right? So to have 6 million people watch an hour 29 minutes is pretty impressive. Next to him, Dr. Peter Attia, which has been a pioneer in experimenting on nutrition science, both, you know, doing a lot of research in the field and research on himself on the field. We talk about that in a little while. He also has an amazing video that you should all watch on TED Talk. Unfortunately, it's only 2.2 million people saw it, so it's obviously Professor Lustig wins, you know, 3-1 on the video context, right? So let me introduce the topic briefly, and obviously then we'll hear from our experts, which I think the reason why you are here. So the title of this topic is self-explanatory. The focus is obviously nutrition science, and I want to stress the word science versus just nutrition. Science in this area has made huge progress in the last 5 to 10 years, and a lot of what we assumed truth in this area are no longer so. So the view on what caused diabetes, obesity, heart failure, metabolic syndrome is changing, and it's changed dramatically versus what was perceived, say, 10 years ago. Because of the rapid evolution that we had in science, in nutrition science, the nutrition guidelines have remained very old, and old is the right word on this. What you can see on different areas of nutrition and food, you can see that the view of science is now very different from the view the nutrition guidelines hold. And that's very important because most people still tend to follow the nutrition guidelines because they're more readily available than science. Here, science, as it happens in a lot of occasions, is ahead of the guidelines. So just give you an example. All of you have certainly heard about trans fats. First research on trans fats being dangerous for your health was in 1996. It was not until 2006 that the USDA decided to force companies to put on the label of products that contain trans fats the word trans fats. And it's not until the end of last year, so 20 years after science was there, to actually ban them, and trans fats will be banned in the US and already banned in several countries in the European community by 2018. So you're speaking about, you know, 20 years before discovering that something is not fantastic for you and changing it. Another topic, obviously, that, you know, is very linked to nutrition is, you know, the massive problem that we have as a society now because of what we think was certainly bad nutrition advice. And one of the things that's startling is obviously the growth in obesity when you take, you know, a 40-year view in the US, but that's very true about a lot of other countries. Certainly the US is probably the worst example. And I can see, if you look at the left, you know, in order to have, you know, such growth in obesity, something else might have caused it, and you certainly can see when you look at the percentage increases there that, you know, fat, which is another topic that we might touch upon today, was probably not to blame. There is almost no growth in fat, and certainly almost negative growth in saturated fat in the period. But look at carbohydrates, you know, there's a 30% growth in the period. Consumption per head went up 30%. What is very interesting about this is, again, that the guidelines are what partially caused this. There were 10% limit on saturated fat recommended at that time. We're speaking about 1970s, and actually no limit on carbohydrates. And as you see, obviously, the population followed advice. The results are pretty evident. And in closing, just before, you know, before introducing the first questions to our panelists, one other topic was very interesting to me personally was, you know, saturated fat and the link to cardiovascular disease, right? If you eat a lot of butter, you have a higher risk of having a heart attack. And, you know, I want to just show you how poor this conclusion was from, you know, maybe anecdotal evidence, but a little bit more than anecdotal evidence. I'm not so sure how familiar you are with an island in the Pacific called Kiribati, but, you know, it's obviously extremely, extremely appealing. But, you know, and for those of you that don't know, as I didn't, obviously, you know, where Kiribati was, or just place it there is, you know, so you have a view of the island and the location. What is very interesting about Kiribati, and I'm going to go over there in a second, is what is the level of consumption of saturated fat in the island. So if you believe in the principle that a high consumption of saturated fat will cause heart attacks, countries where the population eats a lot of saturated fat should be obviously, you know, countries where the level of, or the rate of heart attacks is very, very high. So let's focus for a second on Kiribati. And you see saturated fat as a percentage of total calories consumed in Kiribati is off the chart. So it's being about 27% of total calories consumed is coming from saturated fat. And you look at France below at 50%, 15, 16% is the highest in Europe, right? And then you'll go down the list and you can find sort of, you know, average of the world is around 9%. So based on this, if you believe that saturated fat causes heart attack, Kiribati should have a very high level of heart attack. So what we provide to you is the rate of coronary heart diseases on a global basis. And though Kiribati might be statistically not relevant because it's only 100,000 inhabitants, and I'm sure they have a very non-stressful life, given you see the island, Ispri is still amazing that it has a one-third of the rate of heart attacks of France, who is the largest second consumer of saturated fat, or the largest consumer of saturated fat in Europe on a per capita basis, who also has a very low level of heart attacks. And a very important conclusion is, and I'm sure a lot of you have heard about the French paradox, well, the French eat a lot of saturated fat, they eat a lot of wine, and obviously they have a happier life than most of the people around the rest of the world, you know, and also they don't die of heart attacks. That's a paradox. Cannot be, right? Paradox is, it cannot be. And paradox in science is, in my view, is one of the worst things that you can say and do. Paradox is a way of excluding data from an analysis. And by the way, if we speak about the French paradox, please add, you know, France, Netherlands, Ecuador, Spain, Portugal, Peru. Those are very high fat consumption countries, all of them. So just to give you sort of a feel of, you know, the debate that we'd like to have with you today. And if I can be joined by our panelists, you know, thanks. So I will start with Professor Lustig, Rob. In the last few years, there is a lot of very good research has challenged what we all thought were the truth in nutrition. What do you think are the key findings, you know, of the last few years?
Well, nutrition science has been basically turned on its head over the last, I would say, 4 or 5 years. Unfortunately, as Stefano mentioned, dietary guidelines have yet to catch up with those changes. The two precepts that have, as far as I'm concerned, been completely debunked, and you have to walk out of here understanding these two, are these. Number one, a calorie is a calorie. Everyone assumes if you eat more than you burn, you will gain weight. If you eat less than you burn, you will lose weight. Hasn't worked yet. And it's not going to work because it's not true. Sounds right. Sounds like physics, right? Physics is a law, the first law of thermodynamics. How can the first law of thermodynamics be wrong? Well, every law is subject to interpretation. Ask our Supreme Court. The fact of the matter is, the first law is a law. It's a question of how do you interpret that law. So the standard mantra, the standard interpretation is, if you eat it, you better burn it, or you're going to store it. In which case, the storage is a manifestation of two behaviors. You eat, gluttony, you burn, sloth. Gluttony and sloth drives obesity. And therefore, because it's two behaviors, there's no culpability on the part of the food industry. Everyone is responsible for themselves. That's where the concept of personal responsibility comes from. But there's another interpretation of that first law. Here it goes. If you're going to store it, that is, an obligate weight gain set up by biochemical forces outside your control, the most important of one, which is insulin, and you expect to burn it, that is, normal energy expenditure for normal quality of life, because energy expenditure and quality of life are the same thing. Think about it. Things that increase your energy expenditure make you feel good, such as ephedrine off the market, caffeine for 2 hours, then you need another hit like me, exercise. Things that lower your energy expenditure make you feel lousy, like hypothyroidism, starvation. So if you're going to store it and you expect to burn it, then you're going to have to eat it. Same first law, different interpretation. And it turns out, if the obligate weight gain is a biochemical phenomenon, then the two behaviors that we associate with this pandemic, the gluttony and the sloth, are actually being driven by biochemistry. And the question is, what's driving that biochemistry? And the answer is the change in our food environment. So that's the first myth that had to be debunked. A calorie is a calorie. The second myth is that fat makes you fat. Dietary fat, because it is more energy dense than carbohydrate, must be contributing more calories, and therefore, if you ate more dietary fat, you would get fat. Garbage. And there are a whole host of reasons why that's the case. Because dietary fat doesn't go to your fat cells. Dietary fat goes to your liver, gets packaged in a completely different way, and ultimately may or may not go to your fat cells. And then the question is even whether dietary fat gets absorbed. What passes your lips doesn't necessarily reach your systemic circulation, and that has to do with what else you're eating, most important of which is fiber. Fiber reduces the rate of absorption of many nutrients from the gut into the bloodstream, carrying what you ate further down the intestine so that the intestinal bacteria, the microbiome, a word maybe many of you have heard now, will chew it up instead. So let me give you an example. You consume 160 calories in almonds. How many of those calories do you absorb? 120. Where'd the other 40 go? The bacteria got it. So you measured the calories here, you measured the fat intake here, but it's not what you got, because it's not about the calories and it's not about the fat. Those are the two highlights of the past 40 years nutrition information that has been as far as I'm concerned, completely been debunked over the last 5 years. Once you understand that, what has gone on and why these statistics that Stefano has shown you becomes much clearer.
Thanks. Thanks, Rob. A question for Peter. Longevity has been a big focus of your research in the last few years, and you know, obviously, I think it would be very interesting for you to share with the audience. You know, what your main findings. You know, can we live longer and better? You know, is genetics the biggest driver, or is nutrition? You know.
I'll certainly be as brief as I can about this, and potentially during questions and answers, yeah. You know, maybe we can get into detail. Longevity is sort of my clinical focus now, which is to say, how do you take an individual, one of you in this room, who's, you know, expected to live to 79 years of age and figure out a way to add a decade to that at a higher quality of life? So to me, the most interesting way to think about this is to think about it through this lens of genetics, because I think most of us, certainly myself included up until a few years ago, believed that the die was sort of cast when you chose your parents. So your genes basically determine your lifespan. And at the zeroth order, that's actually true, right? So there are sort of three archetypes of lifespan. About 15% of people are genetically predisposed to a relatively short lifespan. In the developed world, they will live to be in their 50s or 60s. About 75% of people are genetically predisposed to have what I call an intermediate lifespan. They're gonna live to be in their 70s and 80s. And about 10% of people are genetically blessed to have a particularly long lifespan that's expected to exceed 90 years. And there's a special subset of those people called centenarians that actually make it to be over 100. So that's interesting. The good news, let's start with the bad news. The bad news is you can't change which one of those three tracks you're on. You're on one of them. I'm on the second one. I'm pre-programmed to probably live into my 70s or 80s. What's interesting to me is less the question of what genes separate those three groups. And if anybody's interested, we can certainly talk about that. I find that question less interesting because I can't do anything about it. So I'm much more interested in how can you take an individual, whichever one of those three groups they're in, and magically stretch their lifespan by a decade or more. And I think that's where the good news is. You can do quite a bit, but the challenge is you have to be willing to do it before you need to do it. So it's very difficult when you're 79 years old with metastatic cancer to say, I want to live another decade. That becomes a very hard problem to solve biologically. But when you are 40 years old or when you are 50 years old and you have metabolic syndrome, there's an enormous opportunity to intervene. The second point I'd make on that is coming back to something I touched on a moment ago, which was I mentioned this very special class of individuals called centenarians, these people who live to be more than 100. These are people who are studied relentlessly by the scientists who obsess over this field. And their interest in them is primarily to identify those genes, those very same genes that I'm not going to talk about right now. But I find something much more pedestrian about that group to be interesting, and it is the following. Whether you're going to live to be 105 or 120 or 107 or whatever, that subclass of the population still dies pretty much by the same diseases that the rest of us die of. So they still die of heart disease, they still die of cancer, they still have strokes, they still die of dementia, all of those things. That's very good news. If centenarians only died in car crashes and plane crashes, I would be much more worried, right? I would say, wow, there really is something magical about longevity that we'll never get. But the reality of it is, longevity, from a genetic sense, is simply the ability to delay the onset of chronic disease. So I think I'll leave it at that to say for now, but the holy grail is now, how do you go about delaying the onset of chronic disease?
Perfect. Question for Rob. Sugar, alcohol, you know, both have been linked to diabetes, obesity, heart failure, you know. But you're mentioning to me as well, you know, that one big aspect that you focus on is silent killer, as we call it, the fatty liver. You know, can you expand? I think everybody's familiar with diabetes and heart failure, probably less about fatty liver.
So, everyone thinks it's about obesity. Obesity is now the number one problem around the world. The World Health Organization just announced 640 million obese people on the planet today. And it's going to get worse. And everyone says obesity drives all these diseases. Type 2 diabetes, hypertension, lipid problems, heart disease, cancer, dementia. And there's no question that people who are obese have a higher risk for all of those. But everyone assumes it's the obesity that drove it. Not true. And I'll show you why. Can I have the first slide? So take a look at, no, go back one. Sorry.
You knew how.
Go back one.
Oh, yes, sir.
Go back one. So this is a graph of obesity in the upper left and diabetes in the lower left for the United States and all the Asian countries. And what you'll notice is, of course, we, the United States, are the most obese nation. And our diabetes rate is 9.3%. Now take a look at Hong Kong and China. And you'll notice that Hong Kong and China have a very low obesity and overweight rate. Yet your diabetes rate is higher than ours. If obesity is the cause of diabetes, how do you explain that? In addition, on the right, you can see that a Caucasian boy can be a whole lot heavier than an Asian boy with the same risk of type 2 diabetes, because BMI, therefore obesity, is a different risk factor. In fact, Asians get sicker at a lower level of BMI because they have less of a subcutaneous fat store to begin with. And so the question is, what is that risk factor that makes Asians at higher risk at lower weight? Next slide. So I don't have the data for Hong Kong or for Asia, but I do have the data for the United States. And this is how you have to understand this. Here, this is a Venn diagram of the US population, adult population. 30% obese, that is BMI over 30, 70% normal weight, that is BMI under 30. Everyone falls into one of those categories. The standard mantra from the doctors, the dietitians, the Institute of Medicine, the National Institutes of Health, the Food and Drug Administration, the White House, Congress, and the food industry is the following. Next slide. 80% of those obese people, 80% of the 30%, 57 million people, they're sick. They have all those diseases I just rattled off. They're fat, and they're sick, and they're sick because they're fat. And if they would only just diet and exercise, we could solve this problem. That's what they say. Garbage. Why is it garbage? It's on the slide. Answer the question. Why is it garbage? Well, it is true that 80% of 30% are metabolically ill. I don't argue that. But what does that mean? That means that 20% of 30% are not. We actually have a name for these people, MHO, metabolically healthy obese. We study them to try to figure out how come they didn't get sick. They will live a completely normal life, die at a completely normal age, not cost the taxpayer a dime. They're just fat. Conversely, next slide, here's the more important point. 40% of the normal weight population have the exact same diseases as do the obese. They get type 2 diabetes, they get hypertension, they get lipid problems, they get heart disease, just like Peter told you. They get cancer, they get dementia. Now, they get it at a slightly lower rate, I don't argue that, and there's no question that obesity is a cofactor for risk, but clearly, if Normal weight people are getting it too. How can it be about obesity? How can it be about behavior? This actually looks more like exposure. This is what cholera or tuberculosis or influenza looks like. Now, I'm not saying it's an infectious disease, but this looks like an environmental exposure. And more importantly, there are more thin sick people than there are fat sick people. So when you put the two together, it's more than half the US population. That makes this a public health crisis. So the question is, what's going on in these normal weight sick people, thin sick people, if you will? Next slide. So here are two equally weighted people. One's healthy, one's sick. Now, I know you're not radiologists, but take a look. Given everything I've just told you, which is the sick one, A or B? B is the sick one. A, he's just got big love handles. Something to hold on to at night if you want. B has fat all around his organs. It's this visceral fat, the belly fat. So the guy down below in B, he's, shall we say, big belly fat. The guy above in A, big butt fat. Okay? And everybody now knows that the visceral fat predicts metabolic disease unrelated to weight, unrelated to obesity. Skinny fat, if you will. And it's got a name, it's got a medical name. T-O-F-I, TOFI. Thin on the outside, fat on the inside, real medical term, swear to God, look it up on Medline, 1,500 articles. Okay? And now we've done even more to characterize this phenomenon. Next slide. So take a look over here at this, what we call MRI fat fraction map. This is a fat person. Notice the love handles on the sides. But take a look at his liver. Dark, not much fat in it, 2.6%. This is a metabolically healthy obese person. This guy will live a normal life. Maybe Peter can help him live a decade longer, but this guy is not going to die of his obesity. Now let's take the next slide. Take a look at this guy. Now this guy is obese also. See the love handles on the sides, but take a look at his liver. Almost a ground glass appearance. Next slide. And you can see 24% liver fat. This guy has metabolic syndrome. He also has non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Non-alcoholic. Before 1980, anybody who showed up with a fatty liver, it was from alcohol. Now, 33% of America has non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, the fastest growing epidemic in the history of the world. NAFLD, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, and it's not alcohol. Finally, last slide. Take a look at this guy. He's thin. Notice, no love handles. But take a look at his liver. Same. Next slide. Oh, sorry. Go back. You can see his liver is 23%. Same as the guy with metabolic syndrome. And it turns out we now have the data, next slide, that shows, at least in children, and there's no reason to assume this isn't true in adults, that it's the liver fat that drives this phenomenon, not even the visceral fat. Next slide. We took children with metabolic syndrome, with all of these diseases, plus obesity, and we took the sugar out of their diet, and we substituted for it starch, keeping their weight constant, calories constant, fat content constant, protein constant, total carbohydrate constant. But within carbohydrate, we took the sugar out, we put the starch in. So for 10 days, we catered their meals. We took the donuts out, we put the bagels in. We took the sweetened yogurt out, we put the baked potato chips in. We took the chicken teriyaki out, we put the turkey hot dogs in. We didn't give them good food. We gave them lousy food. We gave them processed food. We gave them kid food. Food kids would eat, but it was no added sugar food. At the same number of calories with no change in weight. You'll notice in the green, the change in subcutaneous, big butt fat, no change, because there was no change in weight. You'll notice in the pink, the change in visceral fat, 7% decline in the span of 10 days on the same number of calories. And finally, in blue, the change in liver fat, a 22% reduction. And as the liver fat went away, their metabolic health improved. Every aspect of their metabolic health improved because the liver fat went away. And we actually showed that the change in metabolic health was predicted by the change in liver fat. So the question is, where did the liver fat come from? Answer, before 1975, the answer would have been alcohol. But kids don't drink alcohol. So where did it come from? Came from sugar. And the reason is because sugar and alcohol are metabolized exactly the same in the liver. Sugar is the alcohol of the child. And that is why today, children are getting the diseases of alcohol, type 2 diabetes and fatty liver disease, without alcohol. And sugar is what has gone up the most in every civilized society, which is everywhere, over the last 40 years. It's called processed food. And that's the problem.
I think we have like 20 minutes, so I think we would like to open it for questions of the audience rather than me asking what I'm personally interested in, you know, so please.
If you're overweight, how much time does it take to fix it?
Well, we fixed it in 10 days. We actually have data in adults that we fixed it in 2 weeks. So that we published that, my colleagues published that last year. So you can turn this around pretty quickly. But you have to fix the diet. The problem is the diet currently is, quote, unfixable, in part because the food industry spikes processed food with added sugar to make it, quote, palatable, especially with the reduction in fat content, because low-fat food tastes like cardboard. So you got to make it palatable. They dump the sugar in. And in the process, we've all gotten fat and sick. This is a processed food phenomenon.
Does fake sugar have the same impact?
Does what, sorry?
Fake sugar?
Fake. You mean diet sweeteners?
Yeah.
Diet sweeteners. So the short answer is we don't know. Why don't we know? They've been around for a long time, right? Saccharin was around in the 1920s, right? Aspartame came around in the 1980s, sucralose in the 1990s, stevia now. Why don't we know? Well, there's a very clear reason why we don't know. The FDA, the EFSA, and I don't know what the Asia version of that of those administrative bodies are, they look at acute toxicity, whether you keel over and die. That's called pharmacokinetics. We have all the pharmacokinetics for all the diet sweeteners because those administrative bodies demand that before they release it to market. This is a matter of chronic toxicity. It's not a question of whether one dose will kill you. It's a question of whether 10,000 doses will kill you. Like tobacco. One cigarette doesn't kill you, but 10,000 might. So the question is, do these diet sweeteners have chronic toxicity? And the answer is, the FDA and the EFSA don't ask for it. It's not in their charter. So the food industry says, well, compounds marketed. These are complex studies taking thousands of people, take a long time to do. No one's asking us for it, can't help our sales. We're not going to do it. And then the NIH says, food industry's compound, food industry's profit. We're not going to pay for it. So we got an FDA who doesn't ask for it, we got a food industry who won't do it, and we got an NIH who won't pay for it. No data.
Question in terms of lactose, because I've read a couple of studies that indicate the adult body is not meant to process lactose. What is your take as to whether the dairy products that we consume might have a correlation with early onset of diabetes and overall health?
Peter is a milk expert, so.
I have a lot of cows at home. So I think with lactose, it fits in the category of probably wheat, which is to say that clinically, I've seen no greater amount of heterogeneity across the population than in the ability to cope with dairy and to cope with wheat. And I think from an evolutionary perspective, that shouldn't be that surprising. because when you think about the dairy that we consumed during evolutionary times, it was during a very limited period of our lives, and it was, up until recently, not from other mammals. So it was only from our mammals, meaning, obviously, from a mother. So, and then with wheat, just since we're on the topic, I might as well do a little two-for-one action. You know, wheat looked very different 10,000 years ago, 5,000 years ago. Really, wheat underwent the most radical change genetically around the time of World War II. So when you saw the hybridization and the other factors, long before GMO, by the way, GMO is largely irrelevant compared to sort of the breeding that took place. But point being, when you do these things, you sort of create a new set of antigens and antibodies that, for reasons that certainly escape me and I think a lot of other people, other than through trial and error, it's very difficult to determine through skin testing or a lot of these other generic tests, you know, Alcott and stuff like that, who's a person who's going to cope with or without. So, you know, what I've noticed is when you see people who have an unexplained amount of inflammation in their body, and the simplest way to measure this is a very simple blood test called the C-reactive protein, although there are about 7 or 8 other tests I'd like to include. But even just the simplest C-reactive protein, when you see people who have this unexplained high C-reactive protein that can't be explained by a recent infection or trauma or something like that, I always invite them to do a very simple test, right, which is subtract one of these, you know, 3 or 4 things that typically cause inflammation from your diet completely for a period of about 6 weeks. We remeasure, and then we reintroduce to see if, so it's a take it away, put it back phenomenon. And so in my experience, along with sugar, which I think, you know, Rob said plenty about sugar, which is, it's very hard to justify the role for sugar in the modern diet from a health standpoint. The other two things I typically challenge people to, from an individual perspective, test is dairy and wheat. So then there's another issue around this that comes into the genes that different people have to basically metabolize lactose. If you're in the lucky camp, lucky meaning you don't seem to have that inflammatory response to lactate, to lactose rather, you get a benefit. You know, Rob was talking about the difference between calorie in versus calorie metabolized. Well, one of the beauties of lactose, if you are able to consume it, is you get this break from insulin because half of it gets metabolized as lactate, which doesn't have the same metabolic response as, say, a simpler carbohydrate does. So, very long-winded answer to a simple question. I apologize.
And you talked about the inflammatory reaction that you get. Can someone say that it's not lactose intolerant, so they still have the enzyme to break it down? Can they still get that inflammatory reaction, or is it mostly in the camp of the lactose intolerant people that you find that?
So there may well be data on this question that I don't know, that I am not quoting. I will just tell you clinically, I see those two as independent events, right? So there are some people who think of lactose intolerance as I get gastrointestinal distress when I consume milk or dairy or whatever. That's something different. That usually self-selects out. Somebody who has distress from consuming something generally stops consuming it. The more interesting question is, you consume something, in the moment you feel fine, but you have this chronic amount of inflammation that persists. And you know, when you really think about all of these metabolic diseases, inflammation turns out to be a very important part of them. In fact, heart disease is the number one killer in the Western world and in the developed world, and we're pretty good at understanding half of that disease, which is lipoproteins, but the other half of that disease is actually inflammation. And that may actually explain part of, you know, Stefano's first graph.
Presumably belong to the category 3 that you referred to before, and what mainly preoccupies me is how I, not that I get there one day, but healthy, mentally and physically healthy. So what is the idea of what you're doing to get people there with Alzheimer's and all these things these days?
So I think there's two ways to think about it. And I think that the simplest way to explain it is there are, I believe, 8 things that an individual has at their control that they can manipulate that impact their lifespan by delaying the onset of these chronic diseases, by also, from a biochemical standpoint, doing a bunch of other stuff, manipulating what are called nutrient sensing pathways, and by enhancing the health span, which is the quality of life. So for example, orthopedic injuries, which occur later in life, we don't think of those necessarily as reducing lifespan, but they're reducing health span, and the two go hand in hand. So the, very briefly, I think the eight things that we have control over and can all be manipulated, though the manipulation for you is different than the manipulation for you, right? Is what you eat is probably the single most important one, and also the hardest because of this food environment we live in. How you move, which includes not just exercise, but all of movement in general. Again, thinking through the arc of your lifespan, there's nothing worse than sort of being able, than losing mobility late in life. And so that's a big part of what you, how you exercise. How you sleep, and so we live in a culture that tends to, you know, frown upon sleep. I did my residency in surgery, which was a particularly macho culture of, you know, for 5 years, I bragged that I only slept 4 hours a night for 5 years, and but I paid a very heavy price for that, right? And lost a lot of memory, actually. Very, the hippocampus can't consolidate memories in the absence of sleep. very insulin resistant as a result of sleep deprivation. We talked about the impact of sugar on insulin resistance. Think for a moment about the following study that was done, a very well-controlled study that took a normal group of subjects, normal weight, normal insulin resistance. They used something called a euglycemic clamp, which is the gold standard for measuring this. And for 14 days, they only permitted the subjects to sleep 4 hours a night. At the end of that 2 weeks, they measured their insulin resistance again, their insulin sensitivity through this technique, and insulin sensitivity had deteriorated by 50% in just 2 weeks of sleep deprivation. So sleep matters. The fourth one is stress management. How do you manage chronic stress? So briefly, you know, we all understand acute stress, which is if a tiger ran in the room, we'd all know how to jump out of the way. That's courtesy of one part of the endocrine system. But that's not the one that's typically killing us. It's the other one, the glucocorticoid system. How we cope with that matters tremendously. The endocrine system in general, so how do you manipulate the hormones around changes in thyroid function, adrenal function, androgen function? Pharmacotherapy is the sixth variable that we can control, meaning drugs. Drugs have an enormous place in longevity, but like a toolkit, you have to know which tool to use when. So there's a time to use a hammer, which is when you have a nail and a piece of wood, and there's a time to use a Phillips screwdriver, which is when you have a Phillips screw and a piece of drywall. But unfortunately, most of healthcare doesn't get that, and so there's this view that we use hammers all the time. The seventh is social support and sense of purpose. That's starting to get more attention today, but it's amazing how people are very dismissive of this idea that something as soft as having a sense of purpose matters. But and though we don't have randomized controlled data, we're never going to be able to do this. Certainly the epidemiology is pretty convincing that people who retire earlier, people who stop working on something later in life are more likely to have cognitive decline. And then the eighth variable that you have at your disposal to live longer is your ability to avoid harmful behaviors. And those tend to be very geographically specific. But you'd be amazed when you simply deconstruct the mortality tables how much better you can get. So for example, again, at the risk of being US-centric in the United States, the leading cause of death that is not a disease is automotive. Okay, so double click on that. So how do people die in car accidents? Well, 50% of them off the bat occur on freeways. What's the leading cause of death on freeway? Distracted driving. 80% of Americans are texting while driving. I'm not sure how bad it is here. So it's not enough to just say, don't text and drive. As I like to explain to my patients, every time you get on the freeway, you have to assume every other driver is trying to kill you. Their stated purpose that morning was to kill you. And if you arm yourself with that mentality, you become much more situationally aware. Okay, the other 50% of people who don't die on freeways, 80% of them die at intersections. And where's the most likely place to get killed at an intersection? It's a blindside left injury. So, and one of my best friends from high school drives a truck for a living, and he has watched this over and over again. And it was actually him that taught me this. A good truck driver knows this. When you're driving through an intersection, you look left even when you have the right of way, because the person who's going to kill you is coming from that side. So again, that's a very silly example, but when you can actually deconstruct mortality in its entirety, and while you can certainly not prevent mortality, the goal is to probabilistically increase your odds of survival.
In Hong Kong, it's blind.
Yeah, it says it's blind side,
right. Yes.
So it's pretty enlightening to know that obviously sugar is a cause of metabolic disease, and you identified fatty liver being one of the major symptoms, major diseases. For someone who has, you know, let's say there's someone out there who's after years of abuse, of bad eating, actually has a pretty severe case of fatty liver. What's the best process of going about reversing that?
Right.
Is it eating, or is it exercise, or is it sleep, or is it a mix of
it? It's all the above. So, if you have fatty liver, the question is, do you have just fatty liver, or do you have fatty liver with inflammation? Because once the inflammation starts, you start the scarring process, that never goes away. And it only gets worse. And you end up with cirrhosis, and you will either die of your liver disease or you will need a liver transplant. So catching it before that happens is a really good idea. For fatty liver, there have been two trials of pharmacotherapy, of drug therapy, pioglitazone, which is a insulin sensitizer, which increases peroxisomes, which is where the antioxidants are, so it makes sense that that would work, and vitamin E. But the question is, do you have to go to all that trouble? And the answer is no, you don't. You can reverse fatty liver by fixing your diet. Almost uniformly, the reason for fatty liver is because the fat in the liver is not coming from dietary fat, because that has a completely different pathway. It's coming from dietary carbohydrate, and very specifically sugar. Now, can glucose alone, can starch alone do it? Yeah, but you have to work really hard at it. Sugar, on the other hand, makes it happen almost instantaneously. We actually have the data to show that and support that. So getting the sugar, the added sugar, out of your diet by eating real food, low sugar, high fiber diet, that's called real food. Every diet on the planet that works is a low sugar, high fiber diet. Processed food is a high sugar, low fiber diet. So it doesn't work. So switching back to real food will uniformly improve the situation. Exercise will also improve the situation because it causes the mitochondria in the liver to run faster, and so it can process the substrate before it turns into liver fat. And then there's some very early data that suggests intermittent fasting, because you're basically depriving the liver of excess nutrients, so it has to burn off what it's got, might also be effective. In our hands, we've been able to reverse fatty liver in children with just getting them off soda.
In the United States, there's not yet an FDA-approved drug for NAFLD, though there are several in the pipeline. And it's very interesting to watch the stock performance of those companies, which is really, in many ways, a testament to how desperate people are for a pharmacologic therapy. It is interesting to note the pharmacologic therapies tend to come with nasty side effects. So this is really one of those diseases. You want to cure this disease through nutrition, because if you cure it pharmacologically, I suspect you will see a lipid consequence of this disease, meaning you will trade fatty liver disease for heart disease. Whereas if you cure it with diet, you just get rid of the disease.
Right.
I've heard that cane sugar is relatively good for you. So on a spectrum of ranking sugar, is there good sugar versus bad sugar?
No. Sorry. Everybody
like
wants
honey
to know.
And things.
Honey, agave, maple syrup, gram for gram, calorie for calorie, ounce for ounce, they're all the same because they're all sucrose. Okay? High fructose corn syrup is glucose and fructose free, you know, separated. The data show the metabolic consequences are exactly the same. The reason high fructose corn syrup is associated with these diseases is not because it's more metabolically evil. It's more economically evil because it's cheaper. And because it's cheaper, it made sugar cheaper, competition, and so it started appearing in all sorts of foods that never had it before, particularly with the low-fat directive. And that's why all of this started around 1977. So, no, the answer is there's no easy way out.
Apologies.
Fruit has fiber. The fiber mitigates the negative effects.
I've been told that I have 0 seconds for the next question, okay. So.
Just a quick question, if you want to test for fatty liver, do standard blood tests and urine tests, or do you have to have an x-ray to have your liver?
No, you certainly don't need an MRI, although that's the most sensitive way to find it. An ALT, which is a part of a standard chem panel, will answer the question to some extent. I mean, the ALT is sensitive but not specific. There are other things that raise ALT aside from fatty liver. The problem is that most adult doctors think that an ALT upper threshold is 40. When I entered medicine 40 years ago, the upper limit ALT threshold was 25. The point is that the entire population has moved to the right because now everyone has fatty liver. So you have to look at that ALT with a, you know, keen eye.
Perfect. Please join me in thanking both Peter and Rob for the presentation. Thank you.